Hello, Simeon speaking.
Hello, Simeon. It's Ben Lowrey here.
Hello, Ben. How are you doing?
Yeah, thanks for coming on the podcast. How are you today?
Yeah, I'm good, thank you. Yeah, I'm really good, thanks.
Great. Well, I'm looking forward to hearing about the Mortgage Heroes, which is your business. And I don't know where the conversation is going to go, but why don't we start off? Why don't you tell us about Mortgage Heroes? How did it get started?
Yeah, fine. So first of all, the Mortgage Heroes is a mortgage brokerage company. I've got 10 plus years experience within the industry, worked for a few different banks, worked for a few different mortgage brokerages. And I just thought it was time for sort of me to spread my wings, if you like, and try and sort of bring to the fold what I believe a mortgage company should look like, and try and sort of, you know, give an exceptional service and, you know, just try and help as many people as I can, really, Ben.
And do you specialise in certain things?
Well, I specialise in, you can't specialise in everything, but I like to think I've got a very good knowledge of 95% or 100% of the actual mortgage market. I deal with your basic stuff, so just your easy sort of remortgages and things like that. But I do some more niche stuff as well. So I do sort of look after people who've had a bad credit history, for example, people who've had bad experiences with banks and been declined for various reasons. So I try and sort of plug the gap where people don't think they can get a mortgage. And by speaking to my company, hopefully we can find a solution for them.
Mm. Now, people that have had mortgages and remortgaged a lot, they might already understand how it all works. But I'm thinking people listening who haven't ever bought a house, you know, this conversation might be more informative for them, for example. So like a first time buyer, where would you start with somebody like that? What's available? What kind of deals? Is there any government support? You know, things like that.
Yeah, well, I think for first time buyers, I think it's likely to be the biggest transaction of your life, buying a house, I think. So I think having the right support and the right guidance early on in the process is really important. So the most important thing for first time buyers is to shop around. Martin Lewis would say the same thing on sort of Money Expert, those sorts of websites, because at the end of the day, if you go directly to your own bank, so if you bank with Barclays, they're only going to be able to give you a little bit of guidance on what they can offer. And all banks lend different amounts of money, Ben. So it's really important that first-time buyers understand that. One bank may lend you 200,000, another bank may lend you up to 240 or beyond that, which can make a massive difference when you're actually looking for your first home. So you're very restrictive if you don't sort of go through a broker and sort of look around and get the right advice, because you may not be able to buy the house that you actually want to buy unless you've sort of, you know, been given the right guidance on how much you can borrow. So I think it's really, really important. The first thing anyone should do when they're looking to buy a house is to speak to a mortgage broker. Is the first thing I would advise. In terms of government help, there are schemes out there that can help. So you've got the Help to Buy scheme, which is really popular. This is based typically for new build properties. They're building all the time, so companies like Persimmon, Taylor Wimpey, just to name a few. So you can get some support from the government, okay, which you can get a 20% deposit, which is available in most areas, which is it's like a loan, but it just helps you get the 20% deposit, and you only need to put down a 5% deposit then, which is really, really popular.
So are you saying the government will effectively loan you the deposit, or 20%?
Absolutely, yes, absolutely. So if you're buying a property, keep the maths easy because it's still early on a Monday, Ben. But if you're buying at 200,000, for example, then potentially you could get up to £40,000 deposit from the government, which is really, really useful for people to know. The way that works is you don't pay anything for the first 5 years on that loan, and then you pay an interest only amount after the 5 years. Which typically is normally sort of around £50 to £60 on that sort of amount that you'll be borrowing from the government.
Who qualifies for that? Is that only for first-time buyers?
No, it's not. It's available for first-time buyers and home movers. So it's really popular for people that have already owned a property but have maybe got a family and looking for something slightly bigger but they can't quite stretch their budget. So it is available for home movers as well. You just can't own any other properties. So you're not able to own any other properties. So this scheme isn't available for sort of investors that are trying to sort of snap up the properties and sort of make a, make a rental income based on buying a property through this scheme. But yeah, first time buyers and home movers, but as long as you don't own any other properties, Ben, it would be available, yeah.
I'm glad I asked you because I've never heard of that. So I'm glad we're I'm glad we're having this conversation. I see. I don't know if this is a little bit technical for half past 10 on a Monday morning, but if you own shares in a limited company that had assets and properties and stuff, would that disqualify you from that?
Difficult to say. What do you mean? Ben? Say that again.
I'm involved with some people where they're buying properties within a limited company and a group of people are all sort of shareholders of it. And I'm wondering, would that kind of arrangement disqualify, you know?
Yes, it would. Yeah. So I think what you're referring to is like limited company buy-to-lets. So where people have got sort of owned separate limited company to buy properties through that company, which is a more sort of tax efficient way of doing it. Yeah, they those sorts of clients wouldn't be available for this type of scheme. No.
Okay, so that's quite encouraging. So any normal kind of person who's just got their one family home and they've got their job and that they could qualify for that.
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. And it's really, really growing as well. The market's growing. I mean, there's a shortage of properties in the UK, hence the escalating prices. It's all on supply and demand. So unfortunately, with that comes the inflation of the prices, like I've just mentioned. And it can be really hard to get on the property ladder or to move to a new property if you have got a sort of expanding family, etc. So having that sort of support and help from the government is really, really useful to know. And they've got a really good website which gives all the guidance. But the Mortgage Heroes, we discuss all of this with all our clients. We've got links to the website. We help them fill out all the paperwork because a lot of it is a bit Shakespearean, if you like, when doing these sorts of things. And it can be a little bit overwhelming. But, you know, we do this day in, day out for our clients.
I see. Okay, that's very interesting. So going back to something you said earlier, the high street banks, effectively, they can only offer you their own sort of mortgage products. Is that what happens?
Absolutely, yeah. So I think maybe more years ago, I think more people are more savvy these days because of all your money supermarkets and, you know, all these different comparison websites. So I do think people are more open to sort of discussing their finances. But some people, they still just trust their banks for whatever reason, and they're quite restrictive. They think, I'm going to buy a house. What's the first thing they do? They typically speak to their bank. But I would advise against that just because I think actually, you know, that bank has their own lending criteria and policy. So that client who's going to that particular bank might not suit their own lender, but there may be a lender elsewhere for them that could really help them with their move or their first purchase.
Right, I see. So are people likely to pay more in fees and get less competitive interest rates from a high street bank, or not necessarily?
It depends. I mean, if you do the rough maths on it, I mean, I work with about 90 banks. So the chances are pretty high that I would probably have a better deal for them than what they would have with their high street. For example, if you go to NatWest, they're only going to offer you the NatWest products, for example. Whereas, you know, I've got access to sort of 90 plus, you know, your HSBCs, your Barclays, your Halifax, just to name a few of them. You know, and the chances are, you know, you're probably going to get a better deal if you shop around, like most people do with their car insurance, Ben. Now, when your car insurance comes up, the premium goes up. Most people normally go online and just see if they can get themselves a better deal. And I would strongly advise that sort of all buyers for properties would do exactly the same thing these days.
I remember years ago, somebody advised me, when you speak to a mortgage broker, it's best to speak to someone who has access to the whole market or checks the whole market or something like that. Is that what you are?
Yeah, so the way that I work, so I'm representative of the whole market. So I have access, like I said, to about 90 banks. You can't say that you've got whole of market these days, so nobody can do that. The reason being is some lenders are only direct only, Ben. So there's a few lenders out there that you can only go direct to, some quite small niche lenders. So they don't come out to the marketplace. A bit like Direct Line do with their insurances. If you look at their adverts on the telly, you know, Mr. Wolf, whatever he calls himself, you know, they always say you won't find us on comparison sites. You need to come direct. There are a few like that in the mortgage world. But the easiest way to look at it is, yeah, we can say we're representative of the whole of the market, which is pretty much all the customer needs to know, really.
Right, I see. And then, so self-employed people, that's obvious. That's often, I'm self-employed, and that's an area of confusion, isn't it? You know, what do people need in order to qualify to get a mortgage? Like how many years accounts, that kind of thing.
Yeah, self-employed is a real anomaly, and it's on the rise, Ben. Obviously, I've just set up my firm, so I'm now classed as self-employed as well. It's just becoming more and more popular, I think. Self-employed, or you end up contracting through a company, or you do freelance. It's on the rise. And for mortgage purposes, it can cause clients a lot of headaches. They can get quite confused because, you know, the way the banks work out the income is totally different. So it is a lot more difficult. Most lenders would want you to have a 2-year track record of being self-employed. Mm. So you'd need your first 2 years assessments. There are a few banks in the marketplace that will help you after just 1 year. Okay. As long as your net profit figures, et cetera, are within the parameters of the bank's guidelines, then you can still do it after 1 year, but you wouldn't be able to do anything before having at least 1 month's trading accounts.
And when they look at a self-employed person's income, are they looking at the net profit as being the equivalent of a salary income? So, like, because that's a sticky situation. When you're self-employed, you often deduct a lot of expenses to kind of get your tax bill down, don't you? And so, can that be a problem?
I wouldn't say it's a problem. I think you've got two ways of looking at it. So, from a business perspective, from the client. So, if we take you as example, Ben. You obviously want to be as effective as you can in terms of tax efficiency. So, you know, for certain expenses, you want to try and make sure that's offset from your tax bill. Mm. The way that the banks work is they'll work off your taxable income. So the more you offset, the less you would be able to borrow, because the bank will work off the profit after all your expenses.
Right. So you can shoot yourself in the foot then.
You can, but, you know, it's difficult. I think when you know you're going to buy a property or you're looking at mortgages, I think it's always a good idea to have that sort of chat with a mortgage broker and an accountant, and maybe sort of have a chat as a three if you can, just to sort of work out what everybody wants to achieve from it. But the main thing is it's taxable income. Mm. So banks will typically, for a sole trader, banks will work off net profit.
Okay, right.
Nice and easy. It'll be your net profit figure. Banks will work off that as your income. If it's a limited company, it's slightly different. They'll typically work off your director's salary or director's remuneration, mm. however it's called on your accounts, plus any dividends you extract from the firm. Typically.
Oh, I see.
So
right.
It can be slightly different. And the bank's criteria, exactly my first point, really, about don't go direct to your bank, because all banks have a different way of viewing income. Affordability assessments, everything like that. So it's really important you speak to somebody that sort of really understands the area. I do quite a lot of work in the self-employed contractor freelance area just because it's growing. And a lot of people that find me or have come to me over the years when I've been working for other companies, they've had a lot of issues when they've been self-employed. I'm not saying I can help everyone, but I can certainly help quite a lot of those people and give them the right guidance and tools moving forward.
Right. Yeah, that makes sense. So if somebody's got a high turnover but showing a low net profit, like say they turn over 100 grand, but then most of it is expenses and they end up with a 10 grand net profit, they're going to be in a weak position from the bank's point of view.
Yeah, absolutely. You'd be better off turning over 30 and having 20 as your net profit,
right,
in the eyes of the bank, because that's the money that you've actually extracted from the business.
Right.
The rest has obviously sort of been eaten up by the expenses and the running costs. So they're looking at it thinking, right, 100 grand, but it's costing 90 grand to run it. He's only made 10 grand. I'm not sure this is too sustainable moving forward, is how the bank would look at it.
Yeah, that makes total sense. Yeah, I'm glad I asked that. I think this is going
to
be...
Banks are always out to get us somewhere, Ben, aren't they?
Yeah. But this is the kind of stuff that is useful for people to hear, isn't it? You know, and just kind of changing topics a little bit in terms of the wider economy, the climate, you know, the interest rates, the amount of deposit that banks are requiring. What's your feeling on all that at the moment?
Well, I think there's a lot of uncertainty at the moment, Ben, isn't there, in the UK economy with Brexit and everything like that. I mean, I certainly haven't noticed a slowdown in mortgage business. I certainly haven't noticed anything slowing down with some of the estate agents that I work with in terms of buying properties. So I think people are worried about it, and I think people are slightly concerned, but it's not slowing down. I'm busy. A lot of people I know are still busy, which is encouraging. The banks, they will help you as long as you've got 5% deposit.
Right.
So you can put down as little as a 5% deposit. That doesn't look like it's changing, if that makes sense. The bigger deposit you put down, the stronger position you're in. But yeah, I mean, it's a difficult one to discuss the economy. I'm not a Brexit expert and things like that, but I don't think it's going to have a huge impact in the early stages, whatever happens at the end of March, in terms of the bank's interest rates and things like that. But you know, I haven't got the definitive answers for it.
Yeah, fair enough. I don't know if this is relevant, but I got a friend over in America, and he's pretty high net worth, and he does a lot of investing. He was saying the climate is similar to how it was 2006, 2007, around that period. He said he's borrowing money and the banks aren't even asking for books and stuff. You know, I mean, I don't know the ins and outs of it, but he's saying the ninja loans are back. And, you know, I don't know what the implications are. I don't know what that means, but I just thought it was an interesting comment.
From my perspective, mortgages have got harder to get approved over the years that I've been involved in it. There's a lot more due diligence that gets involved. There's, you know, years ago, Ben, have you heard of self-cert? Have you ever heard of self-certification?
Yeah,
mortgages?
I think that's essentially what he's talking about, isn't it? It's where, yeah, go ahead.
It was probably a little bit further back than 2006, but I think the self-certification mortgages certainly did add to the pressures of when it all crashed. So self-certification mortgages was when you could pretty much write your own mortgage to a certain degree. You could start a job as, you know, in a dentistry on 15 grand a year and say that you think you'd be on 60 within a few years. And my understanding of it is they would base it on what you believed you would be on, which is quite crazy.
That's what they call liar loans, right?
Oh, I don't know. I wasn't doing mortgages then, actually. But I never did mortgages when self-cert was available. So it's difficult for me to sort of give any sort of definitive examples. But no, these days, I mean, you know, the banks are very stringent. We need to check the income and the expenditure if you're paying out for childcare and things like that. Which a lot of people think is a barrier. Customers, they think, well, you know, my rent's 800 and the mortgage is only be 700. Why is the bank not saying I can afford it?
Yeah,
it is a really, really good question. And I do feel for those people because the rental market is so, so huge and it is so expensive. And, you know, it's near impossible to save a deposit while you're renting. And the mortgage typically would be cheaper in most instances. But the banks, unfortunately, they do need to do their checks and make sure that it is affordable. But I'm all for it because I don't want to see anybody sort of get repossessed and borrow more money than what they, you know, what they probably can afford.
Yeah.
So, you know, I think it does give you that safety blanket when you buy a property these days. You know that your income's solid and things like that. As long as your income stays a good level, then you should be okay to sustain your mortgage payments for the next sort of 20 or 30 years, however long you're taking the mortgage for, Ben, really.
And what about poor credit? I've personally got poor credit. About 6 years ago, I went bankrupt, and I've been told that 6 years is the period where it comes off of your credit score. What's your thoughts on that?
Yeah, well, people make mistakes, Ben, or people are unlucky. So it depends. Everybody's situation is different. Okay, so everybody's got a story around these sorts of things. If there's been county court judgments or bankruptcies, or you've been in debt management plans, there can be a number of reasons for that. And banks are becoming more open to having discussions about these sorts of things these days, Ben. Time is the most important thing. So anything recent, you're unlikely to get any sort of support from a bank, if that makes sense. So the longer you've had these issues, the better chance you've got. For example, Santander won't help you. They won't help you if you've ever been bankrupt. But there's certain lenders out there, such as, you know, Nationwide or Halifax, that may look at it as long as it's been sort of more than 6 years ago. So there are chances where it will work. It would depend on credit scoring. But some banks will help you these days, Ben, for sure.
And so are they, I don't know how it works behind the scenes. Like when you go to a bank, are they kind of, is it just a case of fulfilling criteria, or are they literally conversational? You know, will they actually ask what's the situation? How does it work?
It depends on the lender. So everything's pretty much computer generated now. So when you've got an application into a bank, you obviously go through their sort of online system as a mortgage broker. And they'll ask you a series of questions, you know, names, dates of birth, address history, all those sorts of things. And then it will typically have some questions around the credit. And then it will ask certain things about the credit, if you've ever been bankrupt or have you been bankrupt within the last 6 years. So you've got to answer those truthfully and accurately. And then the lender will then come back to you with a decision based on that.
Right.
Some lenders, their underwriters won't speak to you, which can be frustrating with tricky cases. So it's all done sort of on email and updates and things like that. But there are a few banks out there where you actually get access to speak directly to the underwriter who's making the decision on the case.
Oh, right. So there is a human sometimes that you can literally discuss it with.
My favourite term in the world these days. I just want to speak to a human,
right,
Ben, because sometimes it's so frustrating. When you've got a tricky case and it's complicated, sometimes you just need to talk to somebody and explain the situation, because I think, you know, it's a bit like text messaging and things like that. They can often get misread on what you're actually trying to say. So, you know, you sometimes with difficult cases, you may go to a bank that might not have the best rate available, but you've got better chance of getting the case agreed because you can actually speak to a human being and actually fight the case for your client.
Oh, I see. So that does vary from bank to bank. Like sometimes you can talk to someone.
Yeah, massively, Ben.
Oh,
yeah, massively.
I see. Right. Oh, so from your point of view, you've sort of got I don't know about personal relationships, but you've got relationships with the bank, you know, when they, that's essentially the role you play between the borrower and the bank.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think you sustain better relationships with different banks over the years. But you also have like a port of contact as well, which would be what's known as like a business development manager. So
right.
You get a business development manager, for example, for Nationwide, that would cover the Southwest, which is where I'm based. And if I've got any difficult cases or any problems or anything, I just want to see if there is any chance we can get it agreed. I can speak to those business development managers and see if we can, you know, try and push the case through and see if it would be acceptable.
Okay.
Which is not, you don't have if you go direct. So you don't have those kind of channels if you were to go direct to your bank.
Right. So that's where coming to someone like you could be a real help for people in tricky situations. It can sort of grease the wheels a little bit.
Yeah, absolutely. And time, Ben. Time. People, I don't know how much time you have available to sort things like this out when you're trying to sort paperwork and stuff out. But it's really time consuming. I don't know the last time you tried to do anything with the bank directly. But the simplest of things can sometimes take up to an hour, 2 hours. You know, you speak to a mortgage broker, you know, you can often know whether or not it's going to work within half an hour to an hour. And you know, you don't have to worry about doing all of the paperwork and everything like that yourself. You're giving it to a specialist to sort it out for you.
What about different kinds of situations, like if somebody wants to build an extension on their house, should they still come to you?
I think it's always a good idea to speak to a broker. I think it's always a good idea to get that sort of, you know, get that, use a broker's skills and expertise first of all. At the Mortgage Heroes, if we think actually if you're only borrowing 20,000, for example, for an extension, and their mortgage is already of HSBC and they've got early repayment charges, for example, to come out of that deal, I would recommend them to just go direct to HSBC and just borrow the additional money if they wanted to, or look at alternative options, because, you know, sometimes it's not always worth coming away from your existing lender to borrow any additional money then.
Right, I see. Right, because the fees can make it not worthwhile.
They can, and you can't have, you know, your main mortgage of HSBC for 200. You want to borrow an extra 20 grand. You can't then just take 20 grand from Halifax or NatWest or something like that. It doesn't work like that. You'd need to do it through your existing lender, or come away completely from your existing lender and look at it. But that's where it can get expensive then. You know, if you've got a 3% charge on 200 grand, you're paying 6 grand to get out of something to borrow 20. It doesn't make financial sense. So I would obviously then advise them to, you know, either go direct to the bank or look at different options for their borrowing.
Right. Yeah, that makes sense. So this is where you earn your money, so to speak, you know, because it might take somebody like me forever to figure, you know, what's best for me to do, whereas you might know straight away, you know, what's best.
Yeah, I get quite a lot of my friends messaging me about stuff like this. I want to get a new car. Should I get it out on the mortgage and things like that? So yeah. I do get quite a lot of these inquiries. When you borrow any additional money on the house, you've got to bear in mind that, you know, if you're taking 20 grand over 25 years, you're going to pay a lot of interest back over that time period. So sometimes you might be better off to actually look at, you know, a non-secured loan, and just sort of, if you can afford the payments, it may be better for you long term to do something like that.
Right. And do you deal with developers, plots of land, things like that, or are you just residential?
I deal with residential. I deal with buy to let. I've done a couple of self build mortgages in the past. Not something that comes up very often, Ben. Actually, it's not something that that I do too much of. But yeah. I don't advertise that I do too much of it either, if that makes sense.
Right.
So when I said I specialise in a lot of areas, I would say probably self build those sorts of things are probably not something I really specialise in, just because it's not something that's really come up at the moment. It might be something we sort of go into in time, but at the moment we don't really specialize in it. We'd still help, we wouldn't turn it away, but it's certainly not something, you know, I've done like two in about 5-6 years, Ben.
Yeah,
I've been doing mortgages, so it's not sort of big, you know, a big inquiry for me, if that makes sense.
Right, so you're primarily focused on people's primary dwellings or whatever you call it, something like that?
Yeah, residentials, buy-to-lets, so those sorts of things, really. Sort of any sort of residential properties is more what we look at. We look at all the insurances, such as life insurances, critical illness insurances, those sorts of things as well. But, but yeah, sort of development loans, those sorts of things isn't something we're too interested in at the moment.
So a couple of years ago, the tax law changed on buy-to-let and the interest relief. What's your thoughts on that? What's your opinions? You know, did you see that affect people badly?
It slowed down, Ben. Yeah, I mean, the buy-to-let market has become incredibly difficult for mortgages in the buy-to-let market, just due to the way the banks work out their rental calculations on how much you can borrow, those sorts of things. So has it slowed down? Yeah, massively. I don't get loads and loads of buy-to-let stuff now. The majority of buy-to-let stuff I get now are normally remortgages that people have already got a buy-to-let property, or they're doing it through a limited company they've set up because it's more tax efficient to do it that way. But actual first-time landlords that are looking to buy properties, not doing many at all, Ben, if I'll be honest.
Right. Not
doing as much as what we used to, not at all, no.
So that law did change things then?
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. It slowed things down. And then you've got the second-hand stamp duty, second home stamp duty as well. So every additional property you buy, you've got to pay an additional 3% stamp on top of the normal rate.
Right.
So again, that can be quite expensive for people. And then obviously with the tax relief changing, which is tiered over the next few years, it's not as lucrative for landlords as what it once was, really.
Now, you very generously offered a great deal to listeners of this podcast. Do you want to tell them about that?
Yeah, so what I'm looking to try and do is try and expand my business the best I can. So we're looking to give free mortgage advice to anybody that would like to use the Mortgage Heroes. But the free mortgage advice means when we actually do a mortgage for you, we still won't charge you when we put the application, everything together. So it'll be totally free of charge. So the customer won't pay anything. The way that we get paid, so all mortgage brokers, you get paid a percentage from the bank, which is known as a procuration fee. So we get a percentage of the amount that the customer would borrow, which is great. And typically, majority of brokers would also charge a broker fee on top. But for this podcast and for clients that are looking to sort of get some advice and move forward, I'd waive all our broker fees that we may charge. We'll just do it totally free of charge then.
Oh, fantastic. I appreciate that. That's good of you. And so what's the future for the Mortgage Heroes then? What's your long-term plans?
Get some more superheroes on board that are good at mortgages, Ben, I think that's that's the aim.
Right.
Looking to expand. I'm hopeful that got a couple more people joining in the next sort of few months. We're looking to try and sort of, we want to be everybody's mortgage broker, basically. We want to be fun. We want to make it hassle-free, slickless process, easy, straightforward, trustworthy. We want to be awesome, Ben. And I think every company sort of sets out with that in mind. But I just think there's so much red tape and so much corporate behaviours within the financial industry. We've obviously got we've got to abide within the rules and regulations, and we're massive advocates of that. But at the same time, you know, we want to try and make it as exciting a journey as it can be, really, for clients. And, you know, just try and sort of build the business as much as we can on a referral basis. for every referral that we get, the person who refers gets £100 on completion straight into their bank account. So, you know, we're looking to run quite a lot of incentives as well.
Right. Okay. So you're hiring. So you're looking for new staff.
Yeah, I'm looking for a couple. Yeah, I'm looking for
okay.
a couple. I've hopefully got one or two joining over the next sort of 3-4 months. Because you know we don't want to have too many customers where we haven't got the capacity to deal with them.
Yeah.
Because one thing I cannot stand is people not getting back to me in bad service. That is one thing I cannot stand. So at the moment we're not chasing loads and loads of new business at the moment because we're busy enough. What I don't want is 10 inquiries, 15 inquiries on a Monday morning where I haven't got capacity to deal with all those clients within a timely manner. People might think, well, that's crazy. That's money. You should be always wanting new customers. The bigger picture for me is I'd rather deal with a smaller number initially, make sure I've done a fantastic job with those clients. They will then refer to friends and family. So, you know, at the moment, we're doing really, really well, but I need some new bodies in before we really start to push it, Ben.
And do they need previous experience in the industry?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. So in time, I might take on a few sort of graduates or a few, you know, a few without experience, but not initially. No, not initially. I've got a couple of people in mind that I know personally as well that would be able to hit the ground running. So I'm just trying to iron it out and you know, just trying to talk about what they're expecting and things like that. But
yeah.
But yeah, initially we only want the best really, especially for the first two or three recruits.
And you're based in Bristol, is it?
Yeah, Bristol, a little suburb in Backwell. I've got a family, so I've got three children, so I quite like the village schools here. So I'm based in Backwell, but all my advice is done over the phone, all done over the phone and email really these days. Mm. So I do service clients nationally, so I have got clients up as far as Durham as well. So I do sort of cover clients all around the country. I'm not just going to, you know, base myself in one area. I think it's quite short-sighted when you've got the internet that can capture an area as big as the whole of the UK.
Yeah. Absolutely. Well, Simeon, that was really interesting, really informative. And thank you for the offer that you've given our listeners as well.
No, that's my pleasure. Hopefully they'll get in contact with us at the Mortgage Heroes and we can help them move forward.
Yeah, fantastic. I'll put all your information in the podcast description.
Perfect. Thank
all
you
right.
very much.
Take care. Thanks for your time.
Cheers. Bye,
Bye-bye.
Ben. Bye.